CNN learning that U.S. intelligence helped Ukrainians target and sink Putin's prized warship, the Moskva. Natasha Bertrand joins me now from Washington. Natasha, what more can you tell us about the U.S.'s role? This was a crucial moment in the war, was when Ukraine successfully sank that prized jewel in the Russian fleet.
Yeah, Aaron, a huge blow to the Russian military that was, and it was seen as a major Ukrainian victory. And what we're learning now is that the U.S. actually provided targeting intelligence to the Ukrainians with regard to the location of that warship. What had happened is the Ukrainian forces actually saw that warship in the Black Sea, and they were wondering whether that was the Moskva. So they called their American counterparts to get that confirmation so that they wouldn't necessarily waste their cruise missiles on something that wasn't a major target, right? Now, the United States did provide them, we are told, with the exact location of that ship and did confirm that it was, in fact, the Moskva. But it's been emphasized to us that the United States did not know that the Ukrainians were actually going to target the ship itself with their own missiles. The U.S. has been providing Ukraine with maritime intelligence to give them a general sense of awareness about the kind of activity that is going on in the Black Sea, because of course those ships, those Russian ships, have been firing missiles onto Ukrainian territory. So it was, again, emphasized to us that there was no U.S. role in the decision that was made to target the ship. However, it remains to be seen, of course, whether Russia is going to appreciate that distinction, right? Because, of course, they have threatened that any U.S. and NATO role in this war, as it grows, could be susceptible to a Russian attack.
All right, Natasha, thank you very much. It was obviously sobering, and this comes on the heels of learning that U.S. intelligence, the New York Times reporting, was used in the targeting of Russian generals. I want to bring in James Clapper because he is the former director of national intelligence under President Obama and also retired lieutenant general in the U.S. Air Force. So, General, when you hear this, that the U.S. intelligence was used, obviously the source is telling Natasha, oh, but we didn't know it was going to be, you know, when we confirmed its location and what it was, that they were going to use that to actually strike it. Do you buy that? I mean, it is a pretty significant piece of reporting to find that this ship was brought down in part because of U.S. information.
Warren, when you share intelligence with a partner, particularly one that is involved in combat for its national survival, and you're sharing intelligence with them, you have to assume that they're going to use it to the maximum benefit for them. And that carries with it, by the way, the responsibility for U.S. intelligence to ensure that what is provided to Ukrainians is accurate. You know, I've heard complaints from some people about we're not providing intelligence rapidly enough. Well, the responsibility is on us to ensure that the intelligence that we are providing is accurate as well as timely. But once you share that intelligence with a partner, particularly one who's going to use it to kill people and destroy things, that's part of the deal.
So, look, the administration understands that this is a really loaded thing because they are pushing back. The White House is pushing back on the New York Times report that says the intel the United States is sharing with Ukraine is helping them kill Russian generals. And we know it's been an unprecedented amount, a number of Russian generals who've been killed. The White House says that New York Times report is misleading and irresponsible. They say, quote, we do not provide intelligence with the intent to kill Russian generals. Again, 12 Russian generals, Ukraine says they've killed. But again, what do you make of that denial? We don't provide intelligence with the intent to kill Russian generals. That's not saying they're not providing intelligence about the Russian generals.
As I said, the intent may not have been specifically to provide share intelligence with the Ukrainians so they can kill Russian generals. But if you share intelligence that gives the Ukrainians situational awareness, if you help either identify or reinforce, for example, where a headquarters is, a Russian headquarters, well, that's where generals generally gravitate, is to headquarters. So once again, once you make the determination, the policy determination, you're going to share intelligence with a partner, particularly one who's involved in combat, then they're going to use it to the best of their ability and to the maximum extent possible.
So, General, this information is now public in terms of how the intelligence is being shared. Do you think it will have an impact on the war?
Well, as somebody who spent his, you know, a lifetime in intelligence, it gives me hives when these things are publicly revealed. So the effect could be, although it hasn't been so far, that the Russians could tighten up their operational security, which has been absolutely dismal. And accordingly, the intelligence perhaps might dry up. There's always the concern about protection of sources and methods. So to that extent, I suppose it could affect the war. But it's not only javelins and stingers that are killing Russians and destroying equipment. Intelligence is a weapon as well.
General Clapper, I appreciate your time. Thank you very much.
I wanted to ask you about the reporting on the targeting of the Russian warship Moskva last month by Ukrainians. Sources familiar with the events tell CNN the U.S. provided intelligence that helped Ukraine strike the ship with cruise missiles. Does that level of intelligence sharing surprise you at all?
It doesn't. intelligence sharing is maybe not as important as these heavy weapons, but it's certainly on the same order of importance. The real-time intelligence that allows the Ukrainians to combine the information with other sources. They've got a lot of very good sources, Anderson. They have ways, of course, the language is helpful. They have ways that we don't of understanding and getting information about what's going on with the Russians. And so they take advantage of what we tell them, other friendly nations as well, and then they put that together and they make the decisions.
You said that if you were running things, you'd be giving the Ukrainians all the weapons they're asking for. What more do you think they need at this stage?
I think they really need the anti-air capabilities, whether that's aircraft or whether it's anti-aircraft missiles that fire from the ground to a higher altitude. What I hear from this friend of mine in the Ukrainian military is that the ground forces are doing very well. They are vulnerable, however, he says, to airstrikes. The Ukrainian Air Force is still in the air. It's mostly in the air in the west. Russian air is able to operate in the east, and that's where they really need the anti-aircraft weapons.
Also, drones, that seems to be a big emphasis for them.
It is, and the larger drones that can carry more explosives, the drones, again, like the long-range artillery, enable the Ukrainians to engage the Russians at a distance. They were able to engage the Russians at shorter ranges up in the forests and the swamps north of Kyiv. But now that they're on the steppe, now that they're on the plains, these big fields, that's where they need the drones. That's where they need the intelligence to be able to spot them. And that's where they need the heavy artillery, long-range artillery.
How do you think, are negotiations even possible anymore to put a stop to all the bloodshed? Because, you hear from Ukrainian officials, just regular people who, I was talking to last week when I was there in Kyiv, saying, after Bucha, after all the atrocities which we have all witnessed, which the world has seen, it's hard to sit down at a table with people.
I have asked that exact question a couple of times, and you get the exact answer that you just gave, Anderson. That is, the people that are perpetrating these war crimes, what Joe Biden calls genocide, what these things we see in Bucha and in Mariupol, it's hard to stomach sitting down with people who are perpetrating these kinds of acts. That said, the Ukrainians have been in good faith coming up with ideas. The Russians earlier on have not been responsive. They didn't have any authority to make any decisions. So the Ukrainians, we have to take their lead. If they're willing to have these conversations, then fine. But what they are really focused on now, President Zelensky is really focused on now, are several stages, and the stages are winning on the battlefield. If they start to win on the battlefield, continue to win on the battlefield, and in the end win on the battlefield, that will be the way to push the Russians out. And at that point, the Russians may come for the negotiations.
Yeah. Ambassador Taylor, it's good to talk to you as always. Thank you.